Hi, I'm Whitney Espich, the CEO of the MIT Alumni Association, and I hope you enjoy this digital production created for alumni and friends like you.
Okay, amazing set of talks again. Let's start with Don. Regarding revolutionary electrical storage and metal production, so what are the challenges to taking the next steps towards commercialization, and dare you talk about timelines?
I think it's just a matter of hitting the price point, being able to manufacture at scale, and to do so in a way that gives you electricity that is competitive. Because if the price of solar-generated power drops down to 2-3 cents per kilowatt hour, but after dark, when you draw from a battery, you're drawing at 22-23 cents a kilowatt hour, that's not going to work. It's purely a matter of mastering the manufacturing and getting it out at cost. And the same thing with metal production. Just have to get it to scale.
Okay, Noelle. For the last year or so, there's been a clear uptick in public concern about climate change. So is the overwhelming consensus message of scientists finally getting through, or have conditions in the world just gotten to the point where it can't be ignored anymore?
I think both. I think it's certainly gotten to the point where it can't be ignored. We're clearly living in a different climate than we were before. And the impacts are becoming more severe and more obvious. But I also think that people have realized that we can actually make change, and that climate change is kind of a prerequisite of doing things that people want to do to make the world a better place. So better clean air, clean water, a safe environment, that we actually need climate action in order to fulfill those goals as well.
John, so you've been associated with MIT, you're at Harvard, great universities. What can even great universities realistically do to solve this problem, or to contribute to solving this problem?
That's obviously a big question. One of the things that our great universities can do, and it's been stressed already, is to train the next generation of leaders addressing both the technological and the political dimensions of this issue. And I'm very proud of the fact that Noelle mentioned that I was her undergraduate advisor at Harvard. I've had a lot of great advisees, and a lot of them are now in positions of leadership, as Noelle is. And I feel that's probably been my biggest contribution to addressing climate change going forward. But of course, it is also true, and President Reif mentioned this in his opening remarks, that there's a tremendous role for universities in research, development, innovation. And Professor Sadoway's remarks were a wonderful illustration of the power of thinking outside the box and innovation in our great research universities. That's going to be immensely important. The third contribution, though, is a different one than just educating the next generation of leaders. It is educating everybody about science, technology, and innovation. We need, for our democracy to function in a world in which more and more of the decisions facing our elected leaders have important scientific and technological components. It's important that we have a science-savvy citizenry, a tech-savvy citizenry, to elect and hold to account our leaders for their respect for and appropriate reaction to what science and technology are telling us about both the challenges and the opportunities.
So John, interestingly, we had a question here for Don that follows on your question about training the next generation. And that's, are we doing enough, and what's the right balance between, you know, kind of straight fundamental research that we publish in journals and the commercialization part of it? Where's the sweet spot? You know, you showed a fantastic example of what seems to be a, you know, a foot in both camps. Mm-hmm.
I think MIT is a hotbed of innovation. What I've seen here in the last 10 years with the young people here are they're feverish when it comes to innovation and taking the idea out into the marketplace. So I think the ecosystem is here. And just as long as the funding continues to allow people to take chances in the lab, by that I mean if we have a system that adjudicates the proposals, that considers the likelihood of success, that's ice water on this. You never consider the likelihood of success. Instead, you consider, if successful, what is the potential impact? And the ARPA-E first round, they said of the 37 awards, and I was one of them, they said of the 37 awards, most of them are going to fail, but the few that succeed will be game changers. If instead all 37 succeed, you're not reaching.
Hey, Noelle, let's assume that scientists and engineers at MIT and other places make some substantial breakthroughs in low carbon energy in the next decade. So what happens next? I mean, a good discovery that can't be, you know, policies aren't in place to get it out there, you know, isn't doing the job that it needs to do. What's next?
I think what's next is actually what happens before, and that we're not going to have a discovery that will make real change unless we start engaging now. So unless we develop that technology with the knowledge of and with the perspective of understanding the technological issues as well as the political issues. So we should start now, not next, in terms of thinking about developing those breakthroughs.
Great. Okay, so we've got a couple of questions here about transportation. So aviation is one of the highest contributors to CO2 emissions. What ideas are being explored to reduce these? Does anybody want to take that one on?
Well, I would just start with something I alluded to very quickly in passing, and that is I think it's going to be very important to develop biofuels based on sustainably grown biomass for aircraft. Because, as I noted, while there are a few demonstrations of flying very, very light aircraft with very, very low payloads around the world on solar energy, we are not ultimately going to fly big aircraft on solar energy or on batteries. And it's essential, if we want to get the emissions from that sector down, that we have carbon neutral fuels to put in them. Now, another possibility, of course, which should definitely be exploited, is replacing some of our air travel with video conferencing. We have found in our analysis at Harvard, and I suspect it's true at MIT, that of the total carbon footprint of the faculty members in the Kennedy School, for example, 50% is air travel. 50% of our personal carbon footprint is air travel. And of course, most of us justify this by saying, well, we're doing more good for the climate issue by proselytizing around the world or by attending technical meetings with our colleagues than the damage done by our carbon emissions. But in fact, we could replace some of that travel with video conferencing, and we ought to.
Yeah. I should say the airline trade organization favors a carbon tax, but I think they want it set at like 30 cents. so it's not exactly an incentive. No. Consumer transport. Why aren't electric cars and trucks not being more rapidly adopted?
Well, first of all, again, I think others may have comments on this, but I'll start. They are being adopted now at rather impressive rates. It's just that they've started from a very, very low base. And of course, one of the big problems is a problem related to what Professor Sadoway was talking about, is the battery technology. As battery technology improves and you get to the point where electric vehicles have a range of 300 or 350 miles, and as charging technology improves to the point you can charge them in 10 minutes while you're having a cup of coffee, I think that electric vehicles will expand even more rapidly. But of course, you also have to look at how the electricity is generated. A colleague of mine many years ago was very fond of saying that there's no such thing as a zero emission vehicle. There are only elsewhere emission vehicles. And this highlights the point that while we're electrifying our surface transportation system, we also have to decarbonize our electricity generation system in order to get the full benefits.
Yeah, actually, I think... So actually, Harvard's David Keith has done a study that shows that if you charge your electric car using energy from a coal-fired power plant, you don't actually reduce your carbon footprint.
Yeah, there are different studies on that, and they reach different answers. But the point is, certainly, that a large part of the benefit is lost.
We are at the point now where most places in the United States, it is of benefit, in particular for air quality, to change to an electric car. So definitely, those of you who are considering it, don't let that be a...
And I should say I agree.
So, Don, you should probably comment on battery development and how that plays into it. Where do you see it going?
Well, there's two points there. You said I should comment on it. Where do I see it going? It's not going where it should be going. What it needs is needs a radical departure from lithium ion. There are two schools of thought. Some people think lithium ion is a technology that, with enough effort, can be made to be suitable for the needs of electric vehicles, and John is absolutely correct. It's the range, but it's more importantly, it is the time to refuel. If you could refuel a car within 5 minutes electrically, then it doesn't matter that it can only go 100 miles. But if it takes 4 hours or something like that, then that becomes a real killer for the appetite to buy electric vehicles. So it has to be radical departure. It's a new chemistry, and I just don't see the funding to support that radical innovation. Because when you hear about people speaking beyond lithium, you look more carefully, and it's lithium sulfur or lithium metal or lithium this or lithium that. I say no, ABL, anything but lithium. and you know what? And when I pitch this stuff to the DOE, it's rejected because it's, this will never work. I turn around, I look at the periodic table, say, what would be the cheapest battery I could imagine? And the cheapest metal, because I want it to be to metal, get the carbon out of the anode and so on, is aluminum. And what's the cheapest non-metal? It's sulfur. So make an aluminum-sulfur chemistry work. As opposed to, it could be solid state, it could be liquid state.
Could I add one point? I want to emphasize the point that Professor Sadoway just made, that the money just isn't there for the degree and extent and intensity of research and development that we need. Virtually every study of what we should be spending on energy research and development, in light of the challenges and in light of the opportunities, is that the U.S. federal government should be spending 3 to 5 times as much as it's spending today on energy R&D. And that is simply not happening. We need a new consciousness of the importance of innovation in clean and efficient energy technology.
So the way I like to think about it is I take a look at what we've done in our commitment to spending in the life sciences and look at the results that we're getting. We need to have a similar commitment in the physical sciences as they apply to energy.
Okay, here's one, two. Is the MIT community, including the alums, doing enough to reverse the toxicity in the political climate? And a related question, have any of you been invited to be interviewed on Fox News? Nobody wants to answer.
I think the MIT representatives should talk about whether the community is doing enough. I have not been invited to talk on Fox News.
I have.
I have not been invited to talk on Fox News either. But I think one of the things that I stress in teaching science, technology, and public policy to undergrads and graduate students here at MIT is to really think about the fundamental issues of understanding the science and understanding the politics and understanding where people are coming from and the communities and trying to encourage an informed dialogue with that. And so I think encouraging MIT students to go out into their communities to talk to people and to try to contribute to that dialogue when they go home and when they graduate.
Okay, so this actually leads in. We're on the last question here because it's lunchtime. And what should we, as MIT alums of all our graduating classes, act collectively to do to follow up on Michael Bloomberg's charge to the class of 2019 to get involved?
My answer is that every MIT graduate, indeed I think every scientist and every engineer, should tithe 10% of her or his time to engagement with the great issues at the intersection of science, technology, and public policy, to public education, to education of policymakers, to actual engagement with the substance of the policy process. I think that is a responsibility that all of us have to give back in exchange for the privilege we've had of working on the most exciting, interesting, but also intractable problems of our time.
Okay, well, you heard it. Get to it. I want to thank all our panelists, and I want to thank everybody in the audience for sending in these great questions. So,
thanks for joining us. And for more information on how to connect with the MIT Alumni Association, please visit our website.